to our respected guests and seekers after truth. We pray that something that we relate to you this evening will provide you with some evidence and lead you towards guidance. And we say, peace be upon those who follow the guidance. Our discussion today is upon the topic our beginning and our end, relative to true success in life. I think that you would agree with me that it's impossible for us to have success in life while we cannot define our beginning and while we cannot imagine or anticipate our end. In our presentation last night, we discussed the same theme: true success in life relative to the existence, understanding, connecting ourselves to the existence of Almighty God, and then acclimating ourselves and being in compliance with His message. Now, some of you possibly were here and you heard that proposition. And perhaps many of you were not. You'll get the benefit of the documentation of that lecture so that you can connect the two together. Of course, many of you are Muslims, and therefore you already have the evidence of the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have the existence, you have the evidence of His message. Also, as Muslims, you should understand and know what is our beginning and inevitably what is our end. So for the Muslims, I want to remind you that it is our responsibility as Muslims, people having a connection with the message and the scripture, people who are involved and connected with the system, it's our responsibility to share the treasure of that message. It's our responsibility to invite to that treasure. It's our responsibility to instruct and explain the system. But for the non-Muslims that are here this evening, whether one or 100, we hope that you will open your minds and that you will open your hearts for a moment and give the consideration to this proposition that we will make. All the praise is for Allah, who is the author of all existence and the most generous to His creation, while He is also the all-compelling. He is the only one worthy of our worship, having no partners, no associates, no sons, no daughters, no one whom He must consult, and no one or anything which has any comparison with Him. All the praise is for Allah, who is the King of all who claim sovereignty, the only one who has the right to legislate for His creatures. He is the giver of life. He is the causer of death, while death has no effect upon Him, because He is the ever-living, the self-subsisting, the eternal and the only absolute. All the praise is for Allah, who has power over all things, and there is in reality no power and no strength, no influence to cause benefit or detriment except through Him. It is He who created this complex world, the seen and the unseen, the evident and the speculative, the earth and all that is on it, and everything that is in it. It is He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the glorious and the mighty, the powerful, who created the heavens that are near and far, the atmosphere and the hemisphere, the stratosphere, the outer space of stars, planets, and galaxies. It is He who created all of this in detail and diversity in a systematic way that scientific laws can be deduced from it, yet so expansive and so profound that science is unable to accurately measure or predict. It is He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the glorious and the mighty and the powerful, who created and determined all at once, with no pause between His word be and it is, the heavens, the earth, the angels, the jinn, the men, the beasts, the birds, the insects, the fish in the sea, of every species and kind, all created simply by His command. It is He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who created the life and mandated death in order to see which of His creatures among the human beings that He has given volition, that He has given a choice to, would be the best in their conduct and their worship. It is He, Allah, the glorious and the powerful, who sent into this world at different times and places messengers, peace and blessing be upon them all, who were gifted with divine scriptures, the highest of morals, by which to guide and educate the human beings to a life which is legislated for them and fulfills their very purpose. It is He who sent His messengers and prophets, alayhimu salam, with the common message of strict monotheism, which simply means that there's absolutely no one worthy of worship, no one worthy of our obedience, except the Almighty, the One, the Absolute, and who has no partners. It is He, that majestic, powerful Creator, who gave the human beings intellect, culture, civilization, temporary power, passing pleasures and possessions. Yet He has subjected all who are on this playing field that we call life with the mandate of death. A fact which humbles the arrogant, the wealthy, the rebellious, the disbeliever, the doubter, the ungrateful, the corrupt, the ignorant, the deviant, without exception. It is this fact that we need to ponder upon in order to reconcile truth from falsehood, right from wrong, the true vision from the apparent mirage of life. Fortunate are those who understand the fleeting value of this world, the trauma and the swiftness of death that comes without any announcement, the promise and the assurity of the grave and the resurrection, the sorting out, the ensuing judgment, and the determination for the final and permanent destinations of paradise and the bottomless pit of hell. Dear seekers after truth, and dear brothers and sisters in faith, we want to base our proposition upon the sacred scriptures revealed to the Messenger of Allah, peace and blessing be upon him, that sacred scripture which is the only scripture in the world which is still intact in its entirety, the majestic Quran. In the seventh surah of the Quran, the 59th verse, listen to what the Creator says. This is His word. Listen to what He says about the creation, the origin of the creation of the heavens and the earth. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Indeed, your Lord is Allah, who created the heavens and the earth in six periods, and then established himself above the throne. The throne which is above the waters and above what we call space. He covers the night with the day, causing another night to chase it rapidly. And then he created the sun and the moon and the stars, and he subjected them by his command. Unquestionably, his is the creation, and he is the only creator, and his is the command, and no one shares that command. Blessed is Allah, Lord of the worlds. And in the sixth chapter, the first through the third verse, he says, all praises are for Allah, who created the heavens and the earth and made the darkness and the light. Then those who disbelieve, they equate others with him while they have no power themselves. Then he decreed a term of life for them to exist. And then he gave them a specified time in which they will die and be destroyed. And that is all known to him. Then still, you are in doubt. Then he says in another place in the Quran, and please bear with me because it's important. He says to us in the Quran, and certainly did we create man from an extract of clay, and then we place him as a sperm drop in a firm lodging place called the womb. Then we made the sperm drop into a clinging clot of blood, and then we made the clot into a lump called a fetus, and then we made from it the lump, bones, and then we covered the bones with flesh. And then we developed him into another creation that you call the complete human being. So blessed is Allah, the best of creators. Then indeed, after all of that, so certainly you shall die. Then indeed, on that day of resurrection, a day about which there is no doubt, you'll come forth and be judged. And he says again to us in the Quran, he brings the living out of the dead, and brings the dead out of the living, and brings to life the earth after its lifelessness. And thus will you be brought out from it. And of his signs is that he created you from dust, the dust of the earth. Then suddenly you were human beings, multiplying and dispersed through the earth. And of his signs is that he created you and created for you, for yourselves, mates, in order that you may find tranquility in them, husbands and wives. And he placed between you, that is, husbands and wives, affection and mercy. Indeed, in that are signs for people who give thought. And of his signs is the creation of the heavens and the earth, and the diversity of your languages and your colors. Indeed, in that are signs for those who have knowledge. Dear brothers and sisters, and seekers after truth, let us ponder for a moment on these words from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and think for a moment about our beginning. Here in these verses, and mind you, these verses of the Quran are among 6,626 verses in its entirety that was revealed to a man who was illiterate. A man in the desert. A man who never sailed on the sea. A man who never entered a laboratory. Who never looked into a stethoscope. A man who never looked into a microscope. A man who never looked into the heavens. Who had no idea. A man who could not himself have made these claims. Claims so clear, so profound, that science itself has not contradicted it. What is the first thing? The first statement of the Creator is that he created the heavens and the earth by his word, be. Now, if there was a big bang, that was the big bang. And he mentioned that he created the heavens and the earth in six periods. That means that by his command, from the darkness, from the mass of what we call outer space, where there was no life, where there was no order, where there were no human beings, that Creator brought the gases, brought the masses, brought them together, caused the explosion. And through that explosion, our planetary system came into being with the sun as its gravitational center. That sun giving the heat, providing the gravity, and carrying the entire family with it in its own orbit within the Milky Way galaxy itself. And the Milky Way galaxy itself only being a cluster of stars among another nebula. And that nebula itself being among billions of clusters of nebula. Yet, on our Earth is the only planet where this kind of life has been discovered. We don't know that there are any other beings that have the intelligence, that can make choices, that can compute, that can manipulate, that can calculate. We don't know of any other beings in the whole heavens and earth except on the earth. And isn't it fantastic that the earth is the third planet from the sun? Had it been the second planet, it would be too hot for life. Had it been the fourth planet, it would be too cold. So tabarakallah, blessed be the Creator, who knows in proportion, who knows and who has settled and determined the earth and given it its ecosystems in which our life has evolved out of it. So he gave this earth its ecosystems. So he gave this earth a sky, acting as it were a canopy to protect it from stars and missiles from falling inside to kill it and destroy it. And so he gave this earth a carpet with mountains and streams, and placed upon that earth mountains to give it the balance it needs. And he gave that earth all kinds of vegetation, and he gave that earth the majority of its surface water so that it had life to generate other forms of life. And inside those oceans, he placed countless forms of life that we have yet to discover. And he placed inside those mountains gold, ore, diamonds, all kinds of things from which we gain our benefit from. And he placed inside the atmosphere itself what we need just to breathe and live. And from the dirt of the earth, he created the human beings after he created all the other forms of life. This is the decree that has been made in the Quran that was revealed 1,424 years ago. This is not Walt Disney. This is not Steven Spielberg. This is the voice of the creator of the heavens and the earth giving you and I some details. And he revealed this to his servant, his illiterate servant, born in the desert 1,424 years ago. And then he says that he created us from dust, dirt, a substance from the earth, mixed with water. In one place he calls it nutfa. Nutfa means sperm. In another place he calls it turab. It means dust. In another place he calls it salsalin. It means a mixture of sounding clay. All of these themselves are descriptions of the origin of the human being and his nature. Then in the same verses, what does he say? He says, first, we created you from sperm, and after sperm, made you into a clot of blood clinging to the womb. Now think about that. When was it discovered from a scientific point of view, from an academic point of view? When was it discovered? When was that discovered? That the sperm, when it impregnated the egg, became a fetus, and then became a clot of blood, and that clot of blood clung to the womb of the mother so that it could get the nutrition and become a host. So the mother would become a host, and she would begin to feed it without even her own volition. Then he says, from that clot of blood, it began to hang. And now we know from scientific filming, scientific documentation, that the sperm swims, millions of sperm, and only one hits that egg. Then that egg settles in the womb. When it settles in the womb, it germinates. When it germinates and breaks open, it becomes a clot of blood. And then it clings to the womb. Then after that, it starts to hang from the womb. And that hanging part is the umbilical cord. The Quran said that. Then he says, from that hanging clot, then we make into it a fetus. Now we know that 9 weeks into pregnancy, the fetus is there. The fetus, what is it? It's the brain. It's the spinal cord. It's the part of the human being that gives it all the senses and its identity. Then we know at 21 weeks, it's a fully grown embryo. With the heart pumping, with the lungs breathing, with the eyes fully formed, with the hands and the fingers and the toes and the kidneys functioning, fully formed at 21 weeks, at 12 weeks, I'm sorry, 12 weeks, fully formed. Then he says, then we clothe that fetus with skin. Go to the scientific manuals and see what this process has been discovered, if it is not accurate. And then he says, after that we clothe it, then after that we bring it forward as another creature. So it comes forward as a child. Because as a child, now it has its own personality. It is given its own spirit. It is given its own designation. It comes forward, it is named a child, a human with its own name and identity. This is what the Quran says, 1,424 years ago, our beginning. Then he says, after some time, you will die. A fact. No maybe, not some of you. Not the poorest of you, not the weakest of you, but all of you will come through this process and then you will die. Now we know that whether they create what they call a surrogate mother or whether they take that and put it into a test tube, the process is still the same, isn't it? Cannot go outside of this process because the Creator is the Creator and He has determined the system. Now the human beings can fool around a little bit and make a surrogate mother, put a baby in a monkey. They can do all kind of foolish things if they want to, but they will not change the process. But what they may do is that the other thing that comes forward may be something other than what the Creator has intended. So when they start cloning, you're going to find out there's going to be a lot of freak type people. Whose psychology, whose genetic structure, whose mentality, whose physical structure, whose nutritional balance, whose mental order is going to be dysfunctional. Why? Because no way man can create like the Creator, because man is a subject. This is our beginning. You have to say glory be to God if He revealed to His servant 1,424 years ago these facts which science has not contradicted. My dear brothers and sisters, that's our beginning. Now I want you to listen for a moment. We're going to continue this excursion. Because perhaps this may be the first time that some of you have heard this or considered it. So bear with me a moment. Now that's our beginning. No need for us to talk about what we do from childhood until adulthood. We all know that. We know the drama of life. And that drama doesn't change whether we're from Africa or from China, from America or Australia. Whether you're male or female, rich or poor, black or white, tall or short, the scenario, the drama of human development, it doesn't change. So let's go from the beginning of the world, the beginning of the human, and let's go to the end. Now that end can be characterized with a word that all of us like to avoid. You know, whenever people use the word death, they use it like in a whisper. You say, he died. We always use it like for somebody else. And even when we see people dying in war, being killed. Even when we're entertained, we like to think to ourselves, because they're actors, well, they're not really being killed, they're just actors. So the scenario of death doesn't really come to us. It doesn't really reach home. As the Quran says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ألهاكم التكاثر حتى زرتم المقابر كلا سوف تعلمون ثم كلا سوف تعلمون كلا لو تعلمون علم اليقين لترون الجحيم ثم لترونها عين اليقين ثم لتسألن يومئذ عن النعيم. The Quran says, you are busy piling up, calculating, developing your careers, your money, your occupation, your wealth, until you visit the graves. Think about it. When was the last time that you went to a funeral? Was it your mother? Was it your father? Was it your grandfather? Was it your uncle? Was it your cousin? Was it your friend? Was it your wife? Was it your husband? The last time that you visited the grave, when you went to a funeral and you saw that person whom you loved that was laughing, crying, live, boasting, wealthy, educated, denying, arrogant, whatever they were. What was the demeanor of the people when you walked in that funeral home, when that person was stretched out in their last suit? What was the demeanor? Were the people cracking jokes? Were they dancing? Were they clapping and singing songs? No. Silence. Melancholy. Trauma. Why? Because every person that walked in that room, seeing that person stretched out, the first thing they thought about was not the person. The first thing they thought about was that one day, this will be me. So Allah said, "Al-hakum al-takathur." All of us, all of you are engaged in running your mouths, doing your business, multiplying, buying houses, cars, business, whatever you're doing. And when you're told about God, religion, life, morality, you're saying, look, I ain't got no time for that. I ain't got no time for that. I don't want to hear that. I don't even believe in God. Matter of fact, I don't even know if I'm going to die, and if I do, maybe I'm coming back again. As a matter of fact, science is so sophisticated that I think really that they're on the verge of being able to solve the whole thing of death soon. We ain't got to die. If we got enough money, we don't even have to die. See how arrogant people can be until they visit the funeral house. And then after you go to the funeral house, if you got the guts, if you're able to do so, you go to the grave. And now this is another scenario. And you say to yourself, is that it? I mean, 50, 60 years, scraping, struggling, scheming, lying, stealing, fornicating, jumping up and down, begging, working, and this is the end of it? I mean, is this what's going to happen to me? Are they going to be dropping me into a hole in the ground? A hole in the ground, the same hole that a cat digs after it defecates. Just a little deeper. but for the same reason. The cat digs a hole because the cat has dignity, something that human beings don't seem to have. Instinctively, the cat digs a little hole, covers it up. Humans have got to be taught to do that. But it's for the same reason. So you and I, we're going into a hole a little deeper than the one the cat dug. And all the people that's crying, pulling out their hair, screaming, almost acting like they're falling in the thing with you. They want to just jump in there with you. Not really though, you know, it's all an act. Because ain't nobody really going to jump in there and stay in there. They don't love you that much. And then after all the shoveling, after all the shoveling get done, and they fill it up, and the box, you can't even see the box no more, the coffin that cost $5,000. I don't know what did they burn somebody a $5,000 coffin for? I mean, if I was a funeral director, after they left, I would dig them back up and put them in another box and take that box back. And honestly, I'm telling you, that's what they do. Yeah. So after all the money and all the drama, and they dig that hole and put you in there and cover you up, and everybody goes back to the place, go back to mama's house or daddy's house or whoever's house, and you know, we cook some chicken or whatever it is, and we do a little dancing and drink some scotch and forget all about that person. And then we want the lawyer to come now and talk about, you know, divvying up the spoils. So if that woman who died had a husband, somebody else gonna marry him, you know that. And that man who died, you know that woman, in about 6 months or a year of grieving or whatever it is, she gonna come to understand that she needs somebody else to be with, so she gonna marry somebody, so that means if his suits are still in the closet and he can fit them, who gonna wear them? So it really means that after all this time, and the people walk away from that grave, it's over. What about that person in the grave? What's happening? Because you know and I know that death is almost like sleeping. Death is like sleeping. Your body is gone. Your body is dead. Your spirit is gone. But your consciousness is there. Yes, brothers and sisters, you and I are going to know when the people put us in that box and put us in the grave. We are going to know. Your spirit is gone. You can't shout. You can't call out. You can't say, "Don't leave me here." But you're going to be hearing and you're going to be seeing, because that's a different kind of consciousness. But you can't move. And in that grave, this is when the real trauma is going to begin. Because there's a reason for humans to go inside the grave. If the Creator wanted to, He could have caused us to live and then disappear into the atmosphere. But He didn't. He caused us to go into another womb called the tomb. You started out in the womb of your mother, and you wind up in the womb of the earth called the tomb. From the womb to the tomb. This is the whole trip. And this is what you have to think about. That grave is going to be a place of drama and trauma. A place where you're going to be questioned before you're resurrected. And brothers and sisters, do you think that human beings that have the ability to take a piece of earth, dig it up, irrigate it, put down seeds, plant corn, whatever the case might be, the corn comes up, they harvest the corn, then after that what happens? They cut it down, dig it up again, put new seeds in there, and what happens after that? comes back up again. What happens in the winter? All the leaves fall off the trees and the earth goes dead. And what happens in the springtime? The water comes, generates the earth again, germinates all over again, new grass, new leaves, new flowers, new fruits. So Allah says, and a sign for them is the dead earth. After that, we give it life. And then you eat the fruits from that. So Allah says, the one who gave you life in the beginning, is he not able to give you life all over again in order to judge you? Yes, certainly. You may want to deny it because you don't want to be judged. But you will be judged. And this is what we want to talk about now. Dear brothers and sisters, the scenario of where we're headed is important. The reality of the reckoning will be explained in the actual order in which it will unfold, with no exaggeration, no undue drama from the speaker, and this tremendous event will have 7 distinct stages. And we want to talk about the 7 distinct stages of the drama of death and resurrection. According to the scripture here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, gives us a complete scenario. That death is a fact. Nobody here can deny it. Now, if there's somebody here that's got a problem or a philosophy that they differ with me about death, that they're not gonna die, they're not included in that, I want you to raise your hand so you can come up here and give us this theory. Okay, that means we all on the same page. Let's continue. Now, death is a fact. Going inside the grave is a fact. If you don't want to agree about what's going to happen in the grave, let's move past there. But the Creator says that after the grave, so certainly we will resurrect you. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, he gave us a beautiful scenario. He said that after the Almighty destroys this earth as he created it in the beginning, by his word, he will destroy it. Now we know that the human beings have been able to create a weapon which is called a solar destructive weapon. It means that they have a weapon now that can emit a sound that can destroy a mountain. We already know that they have been able to design a weapon that can create and harness a laser beam that can create holes through the mountains with a laser beam. Now, this is what humans have been able to do. The Creator, he says, that on the day of judgment, before that judgment, he will destroy the entire world. Now the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, gives us a beautiful scenario. He says, it will happen in this order. There will be the sound of a trumpet. Not the trumpet of Louis Armstrong, not the trumpet of John Coltrane, not the trumpet of Miles Davis, not that trumpet. Another trumpet, another horn, blown by an angel with a sound that when it comes out, the first blast would destroy all living creatures at once. The sound of that trumpet will cause the human beings to fall into a swoon, almost like they're drunk, but they won't be drunk. There will be trauma, confusion. Mothers will abort. And the opening of the graves. And everyone that went into a grave from the day that this earth was created, from the first human beings to the last, the graves will be opened up and the human beings will come out of the grave as if they were mushrooms. The Prophet said that Allah will send on that day, after he destroys the earth, after he removes the sky, he will then send clouds, new clouds. And those clouds will have inside of them sperm. And when those clouds open up and drop that sperm will hit the earth. And each one of us, the sperm from our father, the same sperm with the same DNA from our father, will come from that cloud and hit the ground, and you and I will come out of that ground like mushrooms. All the way back, God says, to the fingertips. That means with the same fingerprints and the same DNA. The only thing on that day, no one will be able to speak. Wouldn't that be beautiful? No one will cry, no one will complain, no one will lie, no one will exaggerate, no one will blame the other one, because no one will speak. The Prophet then said, peace and blessing be upon him, that the human beings will then be gathered on a huge white plain, stretched out. All the human beings from the first to the last, from Adam, alayhi salam, from the Prophet Adam, first man, all the way to the last. And he said they will be on that day barefoot and naked. No fancy clothes that day. No fancy shoes. No fancy clothes. Nothing to distinguish them and say what their class or their rank would be that day. So his wife Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, "Oh Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, won't the people be embarrassed?" He said, "No, Aisha, they will not be embarrassed. They will be so full of trauma that day that nobody will look to the left or the right. They will all be only concerned about themselves." And then the judgment will begin and the scales will be set up. The same scales. Scales like the scales that you see inside the supermarkets when they weigh bananas and fruit. Same kind of scales. Only this day, it will not be bananas and fruit. It will be deeds. Because that's all we have as human beings to offer that day. Deeds. That's the whole purpose of our life. To do deeds. To perform. See what the tongue says. See what the private parts do. See what the hands do. See where the legs and the feet, where they go to. See what the mind, see what the eyes see. See what the mind feels and thinks. See what the heart, what kind of emotions it holds. And what's the final result? On that day, the deeds will be laid out. And the people will be sorted out into groups. And on that day, everybody will be receiving their tickets and their visa to their final destination. You know what a ticket and a visa is. A ticket is going to take you somewhere, and the visa is the permission. Dear brothers and sisters, seekers after truth, if you doubt that this is your end and my end, Let me remind you and remind myself that this life is very short. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the human beings will be resurrected altogether. Men, women, jinn, shaytanin, shayateen, beads and birds and beasts. He said, they will be naked, uncircumcised, and barefooted. They will be hungry and their stomachs burning. The sun will be over their heads about the distance of a mile. Now, can you imagine that? I mean, right now, the sun is 93 million miles away from the earth, and you know how hot it gets some places. Can you imagine the earth being about a mile from the sun? They will have hot wind blowing in their faces because the doors of hell will be opened up. Now, if anybody's getting a little restless here and you think you need one of them little bags that they give you on the plane, or you need Panadol or something to hold you down, then let us know. Because I know most of us, we didn't think about this scenario, and I'm telling you again, this is not a movie. I'm not trying to get no Oscar up here. This is scripture, giving you the chance to consider. They will sweat until their sweat will produce rivers up to their knees, their waist, their shoulders, and some people up to their noses in their own sweat. They will cry tears until the tears create a flood, but it won't matter. And when they cannot cry anymore, they will then cry blood. They will be shouting, screaming like animals, making sounds like animals being slaughtered. But Allah will not listen to them, because this is a day in which was announced to them. They will have their flesh burned from the hellfire, and it will smell like rotten corpse. And they will ask, they will see the prophet Adam will be there, and other prophets will be there, and they will be asking those prophets, look, I knew about you. Can you help me out this day? They will be stacked up like sticks, and they will have no place to stand on. Everybody will be trying to find some place to stand. They will be suffering that day so much that they will ask God, oh God, please relieve us of this suffering. Just throw us in hell. Not realizing that the fire of hell will be a million times hotter than the place that they're standing. This will only be the beginning of the day of judgment. Dear brothers and sisters, if this is only the beginning of the judgment, let me just summarize to tell you what the end of the judgment. For those whose scales are light in good deeds, their resting place inevitably will be the hellfire. Punishments that you cannot imagine. And you may say to me, well, it sounds like a dream. I don't believe that. Well, you don't believe that you're going to die. You can't even imagine that. You can't imagine the grave. You can't imagine while you were in your mother's womb. You can't imagine before that. Yet all those scenarios were realities for you to get here. And all of those are realities for you to leave here. And certainly, this issue of judgment is a matter of scripture. Every prophet of God told the people about this scenario. And all I'm doing to you, for you brothers and sisters, is reminding you about this scenario. All of us are going to die. All of us are going to the grave. All of us are going to be judged. And all of us will wind up in one or two destinations. No one wants to be in a predicament. No one wants to go to jail, not even for a day. Certainly no one wants to go to jail for life. And even if you went to jail for life, what is it, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, in an air-conditioned prison, watching cable TV, eating three meals a day of the taxpayers' dollars, playing basketball or rugby or whatever they do in jail? But a prison of hell, there won't be no TV. There won't be no three meals. There won't be no air conditioning. There will be the recompense of your deeds and your rejection of the Almighty. Now, I'm not the one to say that if you don't believe in God, I'm not the one to say if you're not a Muslim, I'm not the one to say if you're a Christian or a Jew or a Buddhist or a Hindu or whatever. I'm not the one to say who's going to hell and who's not, because I don't have any guarantee myself. But I am only a warner to say to you, so suddenly you're going to answer for what you did on this earth with the gifts that you were given. Don't be caught by surprise, and don't be in a situation that you were warned, you were told, and on that day you deny and you lie and you say that you didn't know. Because in case you didn't realize it, if you didn't know before you came here, you know now. When you walked through that door, you didn't know that you were going to walk out of here responsible. That if you didn't know before you came, now you know. Now lie to yourself if you want to, and dream about it. And keep this in mind. Each one of you only have a number of days or months or years before the reality of death comes to you. Some of us that are sitting here right now, a month from now, we may not be here. A year from now, we may not be here. Certainly, many of us, 10 years from now, will not be here. This presentation is to cement in your minds that true success in life has to do with understanding and making an evaluation of life itself. Make the proper evaluation. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, think about your life before your death. Think about your youth before your old age. Think about the gifts of your wealth before your poverty. Think about the gifts that you were given. Think about this life, this opportunity. Think about your responsibility before you are called to account. True success in life is just like what the Boy Scouts said. What's the saying of the Boy Scouts? Who knows? What's their major? What the Boy Scouts say? What is their two words they always say? Huh? Be prepared. Be prepared. Now the Boy Scouts didn't mean be prepared to die, but it also means being prepared. Now how many people here would like to be completely prepared? Or some people would only like to be prepared to go to work tomorrow or on Monday. Every one of us, if we know where we're headed, would like to be prepared. Every one of us, if we're taking a trip, gonna pack the bags and try to have everything in that bag that we need. Isn't that true? It is the nature of human beings that if they know where they're headed, they want to be prepared. That's the nature of what we're talking about here tonight. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to summarize and wrap up my message to you by saying, part of success in life is making the correct decisions. And what helps us to make the right decisions is having the right information. We're providing you with information from the Lord of the heavens and the earth, from a sacred scripture, which is the only scripture which is intact. Providing you and I with the information that will allow us to be prepared. And by being prepared, we can reform our lives now. We can rearrange things in our lives now. We can reconcile things with our conscience, and we can reconcile things with our Creator, with our God now. We can pay the debts that we owe. We can pay restitution that we owe. We can begin to do some worship. We can at least say, oh God, I thank you for life. Oh God, I ask you for strength. Oh God, I ask you for time. Oh God, I ask you for mercy. Oh God, I ask you for forgiveness. Oh God, give me the opportunity and I will reconstruct my life. I will reform myself in preparation for a day about which there is no doubt. There's nobody here who went to college without the expectancy of graduating and getting some kind of a degree or certificate, is it? There's nobody here that works on a job without the expectancy of getting paid. So everybody understands consequences. Everybody understands rewards and punishments. Everybody knows. So what we're talking about here is preparing yourself for rewards or punishments. Preparing yourself for recompense. Now I'd like to ask a question, a simple question. Nothing tricky about it. How many people here, inside themselves, have really seriously thought about the purpose of life? How many people thought about it seriously, the purpose of life? How many people have thought about the purpose of life? I mean, even for a minute, sat down by yourself in your room, walked along a road somewhere, in a church, in a bathtub, in your bed, in the hospital, when you went to a funeral. How many people thought at one time in their life, what is the object and what is the purpose of life? How many people? And whether or not you found the answer to it or not, I want to ask another question. How many people asked themselves or said to themselves, if I really knew the purpose of life, and the most successful way to obtain that purpose, I would definitely follow that way. How many people said that to themselves? That if I really knew the purpose of life, if I was convinced about it, and what would make me successful to reach that purpose, certainly I would follow it. How many people have said that to themselves? A great deal of people. Then I ask you the final question. How many people here believe within themselves that they understand the purpose of life? And that they also are convinced about the tools of success towards that purpose? How many people here honestly can say that? That's not a significant number. It means that most of us, one thing I say, you're honest. That's good to be honest, but it's not good to be lost. And it's not good for you to be a mature human being on the way to death, unprepared. So I tell you, Every major trip, every major journey starts with what? What does it start with? One step. You got a smart man back there. One step. The first step I suggest for all of us is that we acknowledge that there is a benefactor for this life, for this creation, that there is a benefactor, there is a source behind it, there is a power, there is an intelligence. Call it Almighty God, call it the Creator, call it the source of energy, call it the principle, call him whatever you will, but all of us need to initiate that step by saying, I acknowledge that there is a power, there is a supreme power, there is a creator, and there is a benefactor for this heavens and earth. How many people would acknowledge that? Yes. And if that is the case, then we can easily come to the next conclusion that there's no one that is worthy of recognition. And there's no one worthy of our attention or our obedience. And there's no one who has any more authority. And there's no one that is worthy of worship except that benefactor. How many people could take that second step? Well, we're two steps towards a conclusion that will help all of us to understand our beginning and our end and some steps that we could initiate towards success in life. Now, if we accept the benefactor, if we accept the power, if we accept an intelligence, if we accept that there is most definitely a supreme principle behind this life that has designed everything in it, including ourselves, then we must also accept that we human beings are subordinate. And another way of saying subordinate, that we are subjects. Another way of saying that is that we are obligated to some form of regulation and law. Now, is there anyone here as a human being who doesn't feel themselves subject or obligated to some form of legislation or law? Because if they're not, then I say get on top of this building and just jump off and see if you can defy or deny the law of gravity. Hold your breath for about 10 minutes and see if you can deny or defy the human capacity and need for oxygen. You cannot. Something even more simple than that. If you have any power over yourself, any power over anything, stop blinking right now. Don't blink. Just don't blink. Or just don't think. Stop the thinking processes. Stop the heart from beating. Stop the kidneys from functioning. Stop the lungs from going up and down in the diaphragm. Just stop everything. You cannot. It means we're all subject. Are we all on the same page? So the third step, after acknowledging there's a benefactor, a supreme power, and the second step, that supreme power, definitely, there cannot be anyone, any other power worthy of our attention, our subordination, and thirdly, that if there is a power, there is a law, then you and I should be willing, grateful, prepared to submit and acclimate ourselves to it. How many people would take that third step and say, yes, we should? Like good citizens, we should. statements is the same statement that we as Muslims say when we say La ilaha illallah. That's what you said. Now we say it in Arabic, a very concise statement, La ilaha illallah. That's what those three steps mean. La, there is no one other than ilaha, no other God, no other supreme power, no benefactor, illallah, except the Creator, who is the one who has given all the power, and we human beings are obligated to that power to surrender and to worship and to obey and to acknowledge. Muslims say La ilaha illallah. A simple statement. Even when children is born, when a mother trying to make the baby go to sleep, what is she saying to him? A lullaby. Almost sounds like La ilaha illallah. When people get happy in the church, what do they say? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Almost sound like La ilaha illallah. How many non-Muslims do we have here tonight? Just let me see the hands. How many non-Muslims do we have here? Raise your hands up. If I got some money for you, you'd hold that hand up. Non-Muslims, nobody's going to take you hostage tonight. Nobody's going to hold you responsible for anything that you don't want to be responsible for. There's no trick to this. I don't get paid for no scalps. I don't get paid for nobody that does no witnessing, and we don't have a pool in the back to dip nobody. We Muslims, we say La ilaha illallah because it's a concise formula that basically means those three steps that help us on the path to success in life. Because by that statement, we are witnessing ourselves, we're witnessing the world, and we're witnessing the Creator, and we're also witnessing that we are subjects. That's the most rational step. Non-Muslims, say with me, there's none to be recognized except the benefactor who has given us life. Say that. None to be recognized except the benefactor that has given us life. Say that. And that benefactor certainly has placed us in this earth with a law. Can you say that? And I, as a human being, I recognize and I submit to that law. That's good, because if it's only one voice among the people that raise their hands, that voice is enough. Because if all of you was a team, you would only need a captain. Now, many people think that the aim of an Islamic lecture is to convert people. We don't do no converting here. We ain't got no converters. That's not our aim. We don't convert. We're not Jehovah Witnesses. We're not trying to make people witness Jehovah and save their soul. And we're not Pentecostals. We're not trying to save the world and save you. And we don't try to make somebody reborn. That's not what we're trying to do. Our job is to deliver the message. Perchance that message will fall upon hearts that germinate, that benefit. Our job is to provide you with the information. Our job is to invite you to accept La ilaha illallah, that there's none to be worshipped except the Creator. Our job is also to invite you that there's a human example in the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, the one that received this revelation from God. Yes, there is a human example. And I say to you, all of you intelligent, educated people in this computer age, you have the capacity and you have the ability to go to a computer tomorrow and punch in the name Muhammad, M-U-H-A-M-M-A-D, Muhammad, the first one, not Muhammad Ali, the boxer. Muhammad, punch that name in and see who was the first Muhammad. See who he was, read his life, read his legacy. And then after that, I challenge you to find anywhere in history a human being whose life, behavior, and legacy compares with Muhammad. Peace and blessings be upon him. I challenge you that if you go to the computer tomorrow and you download what information you can, if it's your father, your grandfather, Winston Churchill, your hero, anybody or yourself that you think has a legacy greater than his, call us up on the number that's going to be on that bag that you get, and I promise you we'll raise 5,000 pounds and give that to you tomorrow. You will not find it. You won't even dare to call. Because the greatest, most profound biographers of this age came together to do the same thing I'm challenging you to do. And they came up with what they considered to be the 100 most profound human beings in history. And out of those 100 most profound human beings in history, they made what they called a categorical criteria. Now, these are the most profound historians and biographers in the contemporary world. And out of these 100 human beings, personalities that they extracted, which included Jesus Christ, peace and blessings of God be upon him and his mother, included, what name do you think that they came up with? I don't want you to guess. I'll tell you straightforward. The name is Muhammad. Peace and blessings be upon him. The name is Muhammad. And the principal person among those people that did that research was Michael J. Hart, one of the most profound contemporary biographers of this age. And they put it in Time magazine. And what do you think Michael J. Hart said? He said that based on the criteria, the categorical criteria that we set, personally myself as a Christian, he said, I would have preferred Jesus Christ because I'm a Christian. That's what he said. But he says in all fairness and objectivity, there were several categories that Jesus Christ did not fulfill in our criteria. One, he was not a father. Number two, he was not a husband. Number three, he was not a statesman. Number four, he did not leave a legacy that became after him a world government. But Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, he was a father, he was a husband, he was a statesman. He left the legacy of a world government. And the last thing is that he left a scripture for the whole world. Those are the five criterias. that they found concerning the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. And this is why we Muslims, we have no hesitancy to say Muhammad Rasulullah. Muslims say Muhammad Rasulullah. We have no hesitancy to say that. With our love, our respect, and our reverence for Jesus Christ, John the Baptist, Solomon, David, Abraham, Moses, all the prophets of Almighty God. When we say Muhammad Rasulullah, we're giving the respect to them and bringing it all forward to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the final prophet and messenger of Almighty God and the most profound human being in the annals of history. Muslims say Muhammad Rasulullah. So non-Muslims, my proposition to you is that you should acknowledge this person as you acknowledge yourself, as you acknowledge your father.
Your battery is now fully charged.
I didn't plan that. Non-Muslims, I propose to you that you acknowledge this person called Muhammad, the prophet and messenger of Almighty God, and the most profound human being in the annals of history. You have to know this man. You have to attach yourself to this man. You cannot leave it open. If you didn't know anything about him before, you know now, and you need to go home, and you got a book there. I think inside that package, isn't it? Is something inside that package? In that package you receive is there. So minimally, we don't say to you that you have to accept Muhammad or Rasulullah. We don't say you have to say that. You don't have to accept somebody that you don't know. You don't have to accept my word. You don't have to accept the word of 1.4 billion people all over the world. Black and white, tall and short, male and female, Chinese, African, German, French, Italian, Australian, European, American, Canadian. You don't have to accept the 1.4 billion Muslims in the world. You don't have to accept that one out of every five people in this world, they say, Muhammad Rasulullah, peace and blessings be upon him. But I think that you should, and you owe it to yourself, to go home and read and check and verify this matter. In conclusion, I want to thank you for listening. I want to thank you for considering my proposition. I want to thank you for the consideration of the theme. What is true success in life? If you were here yesterday, I want to thank you for the consideration of the proposition that most certainly there is a God that exists who is the Lord of the heavens and the earth. I want to thank you for the consideration that there is a message from Almighty God, and that message is in this scripture called the Quran. I want to thank you for the consideration of the proposition about our beginning, of which I doubt any one of you have much refutation. I want to thank you also for your consideration and your patience in my discussion about the final scenario. And more than all, I want to thank the non-Muslims for their participation and their acknowledgement that most certainly there is a benefactor, and that benefactor has to be the all-powerful. And that we as human beings, we have an obligation to acclimate ourselves, to acknowledge, to submit, and inevitably to worship that Creator. In that, our job has been completed. The first question is, I'm a non-Muslim and would like to revert to Islam. Right here and right now. But this is a sister. She says, but I want to know, when do I stand getting judged for not wearing the scarf? Sister, don't worry about the scarf. First, worry about your heart. Accept Islam. We're going to come back to this young lady in just a moment. This from a young child that's 6 years old. They want to know what paradise is going to be like. Well, let me just tell you this. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that there will be no children in paradise. But wait a minute. And that's because all the children, whether they die, whether they're killed, whether they starve by disease, in paradise, on the day of judgment, no children will be judged, because children in Islam are considered innocent. So in paradise, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that all the inhabitants of paradise will be 33 years old, and they will never get any older. So if this 6-year-old child wants to know what paradise will be like, we think that if God Almighty causes you to grow in faith, that you will be in paradise. But in case you don't get to grow, if you don't get to become an older or an adult person, when you get to paradise, you also will be 33 years old. The Quran mentions that in the paradise, there'll be no sweat, no bad smells, nobody has to take a bath, nobody gets older, nobody gets tired, there is no wounding, there's no bad words, nobody has to work, there's no labor, nobody has to pay for anything, everybody has their own palace, a palace. Everybody has their own palace. A palace in paradise might be 5 or 10 times the size of this place that we're here right now. Everybody will have one of those. Everybody will have beautiful clothing. Everybody will sit on brocade couches with pearls and diamonds encrusted. Everybody will have the food that they like to eat without having to cook it. Fruits will grow inside your garden that you just call the fruit and it bends down and gives itself to you. Everybody will be served. Nobody will have to cook or get up and clean and wash and do dishes. Everybody will be served. Paradise means everything in life that you ever imagined, that you ever wanted, you will have it there, but on the highest level. And the best thing of all, nobody in paradise will die. Everybody will live forever. And the words will be peace. And if you my homeboy, and we all in paradise together, I'll come over to your palace and we party over there. Because what else could paradise be? But the best of whatever it is people want in this life that they can never have. That's what paradise is. Someone says, Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum salam. I have found out about Islam about 2 months ago, and this is the first time that I ever thought about God and the purpose of life. A few days ago, I believed, but sometimes I sense some doubts. What advice can you give me? Then you're just like any one of us. The Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said, faith increases and decreases. It goes up and down. One day your faith is strong, another day you got doubts. That's being human. All I can tell you is, hold on. Hold on to that statement, La ilaha illallah. Hold on to that statement, Muhammad Rasulullah. Hold on to the prayer. Hold on. And know that the Quran is the truth. And know that the Prophet's tradition is the truth. And know that hellfire is the truth. And know that paradise is the truth. And know that Islam is the truth. And know that Almighty God is the truth. Just hold on. Don't worry about the doubts. And also, could you tell me more about the beauty of being a Muslim? If you already Muslim, that's beautiful enough. Just hold on. Says, I am a new Muslim and my mother is strong Catholic. She suffers from schizophrenia. Is she accountable for not embracing Islam? Well, I think schizophrenia means two personalities. So maybe one personality won't be judged. But if the other one understands something about God and life, definitely they're going to be judged. So my suggestion for you, since I'm not an authority on that issue, and you know your mother's condition better than I do, my suggestion is that you should be near your mother and kind to her and try your best through your behavior to convince her that there's nothing to worship except Almighty God. Don't worry about her being a strong Catholic. That might be to her benefit. Just you be kind to her. Serve her. Do for her what a daughter or son should do. And through your kindness and through your behavior and through your advice, don't worry about the schizophrenia and the two personalities, because I know a whole lot of people that got two personalities. They're Muslims too. Question. I'm a little confused about Jesus' prophetic career was about 2 years, yet Muhammad, peace and blessings on him, career was about 23 years in total. Why is there more Christians worldwide than Muslims? It has nothing to do with the mission of Jesus Christ. The mission of Jesus Christ was ordered by Almighty God. That wasn't ordered by Jesus Christ. And the mission of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, of 23 years, that was also ordained by God, not ordained by Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And just for your understanding, there is approximately 1.3 million Christians in the world, and there's approximately the same number of Muslims. Now, some Muslims might say there's more Muslims, and some Christians might say there's more Christians. That's not important. The fact is, between Muslims and Christians, over half the population of the world is following Jesus Christ and half is following the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him. And that means half the population of the world is acknowledging that there's none to be worshipped except Almighty God. The issue really is that unfortunately many of the people are associating partners with God because they have assigned to Jesus Christ divinity and some of the attributes of God, while Jesus never said that. That's the issue. But that's another subject, and we can talk about that a little bit later. Another question, does Islam acknowledge cultural practices? Islam has rules and regulations to govern our everyday human life. Does it recognize culture? We know that the Sharia talks about being made into tribes to inform one another. Well, the answer to this is that culture is the result of civilization of people. What they eat, what they drink, what they wear, their language, their practices, their values. This is culture. And every group of people have a distinct set of cultures. But they're all human beings, so all their cultures are intertwined. Now, what Islam says is that anything that is in a person's culture that does not conflict with the order of God, hold on to your culture, because there's nothing wrong with that. But if there's something in your culture that conflicts with the order of Almighty God, what do you do with that? You got to suppress that part of your culture, and you got to prefer the order of Almighty God. This is the beauty of Islam, and that's why if you go to China and you visit Chinese Muslims, they got Chinese culture, but they're Chinese Muslims. And if you find American Muslims, you find Muslims in America, they're Muslims, but they also share in the American culture. And the same thing here in Australia, and the same thing in France, and the same thing in West Africa or East Africa, because culture is natural for human beings. But the guidance of Islam on top of the culture, not the culture on top of the guidance, that's the issue. Somebody said, in the list of influential people in history, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was first. Where did Charles Darwin rate? Well, among the 100 people that these biographers came up with, Charles Darwin wasn't even in that list. Although, certainly, certain intellectual, educated, materialistic, dialectical people here would claim that Charles Darwin is due a place in history. He is. But Charles Darwin himself, before he died, was a bit confused about what he influenced the whole world about. Here we're talking about a categorical legacy. Not a person that came up with a theory, not a person that came up with an invention. We're talking about a human being that categorically had the most profound impact on the world from a moral, spiritual, legislative, historical, social level. Charles Darwin is not among those people. A question: wanting to convert or accept Islam, but don't know how my family will deal with it, especially at Christmas and Easter time. Well, I say this, sister. You know, if you announce to everybody that you just inherited $200,000, you might find a problem even in your family, because everybody's gonna want a piece of that money. So it might be best for you that before you announce it to everybody, get yourself a lawyer, get yourself an accountant, and hold it to yourself, keep that to yourself, even though it's good news. Now, if you accept Islam, it has already happened in your heart. It's already happened. When the truth enters your heart, it enters. So it has already taken place. My suggestion for you is, be Muslim. Be Muslim, hold it to yourself, and when the right time comes, your heart and your mind will tell you the right time comes. And don't worry about Easter and Christmas, don't worry about that. There are many, many Muslims here who were in the same situation as yourselves. And what did I do? I didn't practice Christmas, but if I was with those people and they want to give me a Christmas gift, I took it. I didn't say Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. I just said, thanks a lot. A non-Muslim says, why do you think it is not logical for someone to be held responsible for their actions, like Jesus dying for the sins of the world? Well, first of all, in all fairness, if Jesus died for the sins of the whole world, I mean, well, how many years ago was that? That was like 2004 years ago? So if Jesus died for the sins of the world, if that is a principle, now Jesus didn't say that, but somebody else said it, but let's say that that's a principle. Now if Jesus died for the whole world, that means whatever sins anybody committed since Jesus died, ain't no more judgment for them. Wouldn't that be right? Now the second thing is, how could it be that Jesus died for the whole world, and at the same token, every child is born with sin? Now tell me how that, hook that up for me. Explain that to me. Now that would be double jeopardy for Jesus and the newborn child. That'd be double jeopardy. That doesn't make sense. And that's not based on scripture. That's based upon another theory and another set of principles that a group of people came up with that we don't need to discuss right here, because our discussion is not about the Pauline doctrine or the Council of Nicaea or the Council of Ephesus or any of those doctrines. That's not our discussion. The issue here is that that's not based on scripture of Jesus Christ, and it's not consistent with the scripture of any prophets. So we don't accept that. What does the Quran say about Mary? Mary, the mother of Jesus Christ. Let me see, just a minute. Well, what the Quran says about Mary, well, what it says about Mary, it is the 19th chapter of the Quran, and it has 98 verses. That's what the Quran says about Mary. The Quran is so profound. The proof that Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, he didn't write, nor did he dictate the Quran, because if he did, certainly he would have made a chapter for himself. There should have been a chapter in here called Muhammad. There should have been a chapter in here with his mother's name. His mother's name was Amina. There should be a chapter in here for his mother. But there's no chapter in here with the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam's name, and there's no chapter in here with the name of Amina. But there is a chapter here with the mother of Jesus Christ. It's the 19th chapter of the Quran, and anyone who wants a copy of the Quran here, we can make it available for them, there's no problem, and you can read those 98 verses for yourself, and I'll tell you that if you're a believer in Almighty God and a lover of Jesus, when you read it, you're gonna cry. What does the word Quran mean? Quran means the recital, the reading, the word of Almighty God. That's what Quran means. It is a word sent down from Almighty God upon the heart of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, in the form of a revelation that now is for us a scripture of legislation, making all things clear and detailed for our life. Quran, it's a recital. And that's why when we recite it, when we read it, it is also a recital. And let me just give you just a little bit, just so you can hear it. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Inna lil muttaqina mafaza. حدائق وأعنابا وكوائب أترابا وكأسا دحاقا لا يسمعون فيها لغوا ولا كذابا جزاء من ربك عطاء حسابا رب السماوات والأرض وما بينهما الرحمن لا يملكون منه خطابا. This is the Quran. This is the recital. The Quran is a recital. The Quran is a medicine. The Quran is a healing. The Quran is the word and the scripture from Almighty God revealed to his messenger 1,424 years ago, 6,626 verses retained and memorized by millions of Muslims in the world today. Every human being needs to read the Quran and build a relationship. It will open up a door for you that you never saw before. What does God say about the reason he created us? He says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. It is he, Almighty Allah, who created you, who created the death and the life, in order to see which one of us would be the best in our conduct. That's what he says. The reason for the creation of the human beings is to see which one of them would be the best in their conduct. So therefore, he has given us the opportunity to strive as in a race towards what is good. It says, in one sentence, can you answer the question, what is the true success in life? The true success in life is to acknowledge the Creator. The true success in life is to be in obedience and compliance to the Creator. The true success in life is to imitate and to follow the most profound conduct and behavior and human example that has been sent into this life for all the human beings. The true success in life is to submit yourselves in Islam. The final question that I have here is, does the Quran have miracles? Certainly it does. I could enumerate at least 15 or 20 to you, but it's not necessary. I say to you that this book was revealed to an illiterate prophet, that means an unlettered prophet, 1,424 years ago. It was memorized over a period of 23 years, it was revealed. And it was memorized by the prophet himself, peace and blessing be upon him, and it was memorized by several of his companions, and he reviewed their memorization of it, and the angel Gabriel that brought it to him reviewed his memorization of it. And so when the prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, passed away, there were several companions of his that had memorized this whole Quran under his review. And since that time, millions of Muslims have memorized the Quran in every age. And I almost guarantee you that there's probably at least two or three or four Muslims in this gathering here that have memorized this whole Quran or the greater portion of it. And another miracle of this Quran that cannot be said for any other book is that if all the Bibles, if all the Talmuds, if all the Hindu scriptures, all the Buddhist scriptures, if all those books were thrown in the ocean, if all those people of those religions agreed, throw them all in the ocean, and then we Muslims, we threw all the Qurans in the ocean also. The Quran is the only one that in a matter of a day or two would be brought right back because it has been memorized from cover to cover. No one else can say that because no one else really even agrees to the completion or what is completely the Bible or any other book. So the Quran is its own miracle. Although there are miracles of the Quran and miracles of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, the real miracle of the Quran is the Quran itself. Brothers and sisters, and seekers after truth, our esteemed, respected guests, we appreciate so much your indulgence. That young lady that asked to accept Islam, if you want to accept Islam right now, you can come forward. Who's the young lady? The excitement of our brothers and people, actually they're happy because they're saying God is great. It's not like a rugby match. They're just saying God is great. And we Muslims, we don't really whistle and clap. That's not what we do. That's not from the Sunnah. But if we want to say God is great, that's an exclamation that we're making because of excitement and because of being happy and good feeling. These four young ladies I mean, I thought the question was for one, but mashallah, this is the greatness of Allah. We'd like to also ask, is there any other non-Muslim that would like to come forward or just raise their hands and make the acknowledgement along with these young ladies? Is there anybody else? If so, just come down, or if there's anyone who themselves is a bit shy, if there's someone that's a bit shy, then we'll have a room and a session that we can talk to you at a little bit later, inshallah. I have witnessed myself accepting Islam out of the nearly 7,000 people that I have seen personally accept Islam. I will say to you that 65 or 70% were women. And this is an indication itself, this is proof enough that there's enough beauty in Islam that with all the distortions that people seem to throw out about it and the oppression of women and something like that, these women didn't buy that. The beauty of Islam, the balance of Islam, the treasure of Islam seems quite evident. And so, to make things very easy, this is not a ritual. This is just a means of making a public proclamation. And may Allah bless you ladies, for being courageous enough to come here and start the transition and to enter the transaction, because that's what it is. You're making a transition, but you're also entering a transaction with the Creator. Not with me, with the Creator. So I want you to say these words after me, and they're simple words. I'm going to translate afterwards to make sure that you understand what you said, okay? Say, A'udhu Billahi من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم آمين. The Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, he used to add something for people who entered Islam from Christianity to make something clear. He used to ask them to acknowledge that I accept that Jesus Christ is a prophet and messenger of Almighty God, a spirit and a word from Mary who was pure. So this is what he used to ask the Christians to say to make sure that they severed from themselves this issue of that Jesus is the Son or that he is divine. So I want you to say, and I bear witness that Jesus Christ is a prophet and messenger of God, and that he is a word and a spirit given to Mary who was pure and chaste. Amen.
A couple more words here.
Now, this package is sort of a new Muslim starters kit. Now, there are brothers and sisters who also new Muslims and new Muslim helpers who will answer any questions that you have, who will give you the support that you need, who will provide you with any kind of help you work out any kind of problems that you have. That's exactly what they do. We want to say to you that one of the benefits of becoming Muslim is that if there's something you owed God, something you did in your lives that only you know and God knows, today it's forgiven, it's finished. You start with a clean slate with God. But if you owe somebody money, you still got to pay that. God can't forgive debts that you owe other people, you see? So we want you to be sincere. The whole thing about Islam is, don't think that you got to flip overnight and tomorrow you got to start following all the rules. It's not like that. You're not going to change overnight. But use your sincerity. Be sincere towards God. Start to learn, start to read, start making the changes in your life. And use your own intelligence to determine whether your family, your colleagues, your neighbors, your friends, how you want to deal with that. But keep this in mind, thousands of us met the same challenges, and you'll come through them also, okay? May Allah bless all of you. Okay? Thank you so much. Okay? I said that there's not a chapter in the Quran named Muhammad. There is a chapter named Muhammad, but Muhammad did not name it himself. This is what I meant to say. Thank you very much, brother. Alhamdulillah. And it's chapter number 47. I meant to say that Muhammad did not name the chapter himself. Thank you. What I want to say for those sisters who just became Muslim, the people who brought them, who advised them, who counseled them, who encouraged them, you have a direct responsibility to these sisters. You can't just leave them out there to work things out for themselves. You have to provide them with the support that they need. Whatever kind of support it is, you're responsible for that. If these young ladies, if they somehow are connected to young Muslim men, you young Muslim men, you got to make that relationship correct. You have to make it correct. If these young ladies are connected to sisters, other Muslim sisters who advise them or encourage them, those Muslim sisters have to stay next to them and help them work through whatever. But keep this in mind, those Muslim sisters should not act as guardians for them. They cannot be guardians for them. They can encourage them and be close to them, be friends with them, but they should try to stabilize them under some kind of formal guardianship so someone can work out those problems that they're going to run into. Because any change that we make in our lives, any major change, always involves some kind of challenge. We want to end our session here this evening with gratitude for your patience, for your tolerance, and those who disagree with whatever it is. If I said something good, it was from God. If I said something other than that, that was from me. If there's any non-Muslims that would like to sit with me afterwards for a few moments, you come over this way. The brothers will direct you to a place where we can sit for a few moments. I want to thank everybody. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika wa ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta wa astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.